Hello, YouTube.
Well, it's been a little while, and last you saw me, I was working on an Altair micro, my clone of the Briel Altair micro 880 computer. And he's got a really nice replica one computer, which is the Apple One clone. I've always wanted to do a 6502, growing up with the Commodore 64. It's a natural machine, but I'm looking to have one that's got a little bit more capability than the Apple One. Maybe not quite as much as a Commodore 64. It would be hard to do that level of sound and graphics. To design it and build it myself, but I think I can do a little better than an Apple One. At least I hope I can. Here's my design so far, the schematic. What I've done is I've kind of spec'd out a machine somewhere in between a replica one and an Apple Two, let's say. And I'm in my lab here. Let's see. Just beginning the breadboard to prove out my schematic design. I've already found a ton of bugs. I want to try and shake out the entire thing and get it running before I have boards made to try and save a little bit of money. Only have the boards made once, right? Should make sense. So here's where I am. I had missed a connection on the oscillator there, and I wasn't getting a clock signal. Just trying to bring this board up really slowly. So far, what I've got is a parallax propeller, which will do the video card, at least in the early stages of this design. To the left there, I think I've got, was that one of the glue logic chips? Let's see, a power indicator light up top. I've got 5 volt and 3.3 volt voltage regulator. You can see a propeller plug there for in-circuit programming. That little chip there is a 555, a 555, and I'm using a little tack switch there. This is kind of neat. I took this design directly out of the Commodore 64 service manual. I was watching Ben Heckendorn build a clone of an Apple One, very much like the replica one. And I noticed when he first powered it on, he didn't get a cursor because the 6502 microprocessor was booting faster than the propeller could download its code from its EEPROM, which is right above the chip there, and start running the terminal emulator. And so he would have to reset it manually. So I got to thinking, if I include that little timer circuit, which will hold the reset down on the 6502 over here until the propellers had time to boot, then you wouldn't have to manually reset it. It would look kind of cool. So anyways, I pieced all that stuff together. I tested the timer circuit. That works. That will cause a delayed power on of the 6502. Oh, okay. Notice over here, somehow I ended up ordering a one-time programmable 27256 EEPROM, I think I got, 32K. I burned it once. That was a mistake. I should have gotten the kind of EEPROM that's got the window in it that's ultraviolet erasable. Anyways, just below it is a RAM chip, 32K. SRAM, the same exact variety, 62256 that I used with the Altair micro clone. Over here, incidentally, I have an old 486 computer. I had this thing when I was in college, and many years, I'd say maybe 10 years ago, I purchased a Needham PB10 EEPROM programmer. It's actually an ISA 16 card. That's why I need this old computer. It's literally a card plugged into this old DOS computer. And then let's see, from eBay, I got a Chinese EEPROM eraser. This thing's actually pretty neat, and it was very cheap. You just simply pull the drawer out. If I can do this with one hand without setting off some sort of avalanche. Yeah, you just put your EEPROMs in the drawer there with the little piece of tape or label that might be covering up the glass window removed. Stick your EEPROM in the drawer, close the drawer, you know, make sure it's plugged in and turned on, of course. Then you set your timer. I found out about 20 minutes, and then that erases the EEPROM completely. And then you get this little ZIF socket here, which opens up, and then you can put your chip in and with zero force, and then just snap it closed. And it uses a DOS program, which this computer is very old, but it's just new enough to have a CD-ROM drive. And thank goodness you can still write CD-ROMs. It can't play DVDs, but I can read CD-ROMs. So I'll burn whatever ROM image I need onto a CD-ROM, put it into that computer, erase the EEPROM in the eraser, burn it in the burner, and then plug it into the computer with new ROM software. Yeah, so anyways, these two chips here are Glue Logic. Basically, I'm using very simple, I have a 7400, a 7404, which, is that covered up by my probes? I won't waste any more of your time looking for it. Basically, the 7404 is only connected to, I believe, yeah, it's connected, there it is. It's connected to the 6821 peripheral interface adapter, one signal on that, and I believe I'm using another signal with my 555 timer. In fact, that's why that chip is over here and not with the rest of the board over here. So the other chips that comprise the Glue Logic 7400, of course, I already mentioned that, and then the 74LS138. Actually, I'm using an HET version. It's a little faster. It's just what I had on hand. I think that's going to be okay with either part, but that is a, I believe that's called a 1-to-8 encoder. Anyways, those Glue Logic chips allow the processor to talk to very specific portions of the ROM. The RAM is 32K, and so that was very easily switchable in binary. If you spell out anything above the lower 32K, you'll light, well, you won't light it, the A15 line will go high, and so basically if that line goes high, it turns off the RAM off the bus and would turn on the EEPROM. So it's very simple to switch between RAM and ROM. The ROM locations, and I don't have the memory map handy, I don't think I have it written down anywhere down here, but the way that you can switch between the different versions, the different areas of the ROM chip is with the Glue Logic decoding. That's important because not all of the ROM, not all 32K will be online on this computer. Right now, the way it's in the schematic, I've only got 8K of the ROM. Basically, 2 4K chunks. One chunk has got the Apple Integer Basic, and the other chunk has both an assembler and a very simple monitor program. Right now, very close to what the Replica 1 has, and what I'm going to try to do and test out on this breadboard is see if I can't easily switch in another 8KB block of the ROM and make that available to the computer without adding too many more chips, hopefully without adding any more chips. And in that 8KB space, I'll put a much more advanced monitor program and use that as the operating system. Anyways, enough of my jabbering on, right? Let's show you something cool here. So here's my oscilloscope here. Turn this guy on, and he's booting up. Okay, any day now. All right, and it appears to be running. And what we'll do here is now I'll turn my regulated power supply on. Oops, I'll do it and I'll mean it this time. How's that? Okay, beeps at me. All right, set for 9 volts, which it'll send into the voltage regulator circuit as soon as I press the output button. And what I'll do, okay, I've just turned it on, and geez, let's clear this display up a little bit here. What we have shown here, okay, I just adjusted the all right, the top portion, that yellow bit there, what that is that is the 1 megahertz oscillator, which I've now got working. That's going to be the heartbeat, so to speak, for the 6502. This bottom guy that's sort of moving real crazy here, that is the 5 megahertz crystal that the parallax propeller uses. And to make this a little more readable, let's see, I'm gonna turn this persist mode. Yeah, there we go. And I kinda like this, right? This, if we get rid of that menu display, now with that persist mode, you can pretty clearly see that the 5 megahertz is going in. There's 5 waveforms inside of each of the 1 megahertz. I forget what that's called, but the one down and one up portion completes one entire time frame. And shucks, I'm at a loss for words. I guess that means I'm talking too long. Anyways, that's it. That's where we are so far. Believe it or not, all these wires, that's pretty much just comprising enough to get the power supply and the propeller able to download code from the propeller plug there. A little bit of my timer circuit is set up. And then basically just the timing and the power connections for the CPU, RAM, ROM, and the 6821. So there'll be a lot more wires on this thing before it's time to for it to run a little bit. And then once it is running, I will get a chance to try out that new to me logic analyzer there, which I just scored off of eBay for dirt cheap. $52 including shipping. That thing cost over $10,000 when it was new in 1987. And it's not really good for anything, but these old 8-bit machines now, I mean, you could probably work on 16-bit machines as well, but I'm sure that the new equipment has surpassed that by far. Anyways, super valuable to me. I'm glad to have it. And that's it, man. This was a long one. I apologize. Hopefully next time we'll see this machine a lot further along. So stay tuned, because once I get it all proved out, I'll be making some circuit boards again. And then I'll design a new case, and hope to have a pretty neat machine. Maybe if there's any interest in it, maybe sell a few, or just use it as I used the last computer. It's a learning project. So that's it for me. I'll talk to y'all next time. Thanks. Bye.